subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
After hesitating for several days, simply because I didn't know what was the perfect day to talk about this, because in news, you need a big news peg to talk about something. I am finally talking about China's province of Xinjiang, or what we used to call Xinjiang in the past, and also its Muslim minorities, especially the Uyghurs, and what's happening there. And the reason we are talking about that now, as I said, little bits of news keeps coming out all the time. Now two big things have come out, essentially beginning with a study that Canberra-based Australian Strategic Policy Institute has produced. Based on this study, the global media has then studied the evidence in this study. This study was led by Nathan Ruzer, who is very much a cyber satellite expert. We have often quoted from him and quoted his tweets on the India-China situation, because he's a very smart guy. He knows how to read satellite pictures. He also knows how to find those satellite pictures. These are very special skills. So this is a study he has done, with Nathan Ruzer has done, with Dr. James Leibold, Kelsey Munro, and Till Hoja. And this is the Australian Cyber Policy Center at Australian Strategic Policy Institute, SP. So this study now tells you how many of the Muslim mosques in the province of Xinjiang have been destroyed, desecrated, not just mosques, but also mazars, cemeteries, graveyards. And they actually give us the evidence that, one, nearly 18,000 mosques and graveyards and other places of worship have been demolished over time. In the last 4 years, 1/3 of all existing mosques had been demolished in Xinjiang. That's part of, obviously, the Chinese government's Sinicization or Sinification drive, where they want all minorities to become like the rest of the Chinese. This has been accompanied by a change in the demographic balance of the area, with a lot of the Han Chinese migrating from the rest of the country. So in fact, if you look at Xinjiang today, it will be about half and half, or maybe a little more than half probably will be the Han Chinese. So Uyghurs will be a minority within their own state. Remember though, that in the Chinese system, they don't regard Uyghurs as indigenous to Xinjiang, because you know what happens when you are indigenous to some place, then you can say, this is my majority, or this is my near majority, this is my area. They regard them as a national minority, which means work with the presumption that Uyghurs are spread all over China, they belong to all of China, so they can claim no special rights in the province of Xinjiang, although it's called an autonomous province. That is how things work in China. Now, before I get into more details, you might find this Karta clutter a little bit unconventional, and I'll tell you why. Many of you, and I read your comments very carefully, many of you in your comments call me a professor, particularly the younger ones among you. And fortunately, we have a very large number of young watchers and listeners. So thank you very much for being there. So I don't know whether you called me a professor or uncle or grandfather because you think I am wise, or because maybe you're pulling my leg because you know that I don't have such high degrees, except a few honorary doctorates, which count for nothing, unlike Jayalalitha's, right, or Vijay Mallya's. I don't go around saying Dr. Shekhar Gupta, because I'm not. Let me play the professor in a journalism school for just 30 seconds before you. So when you go to a journalism school, you are told there are 6 elements of news, 5 W's and 1 H. What are these 5 W's? What, where, who, why, when? And 1 H is how. What has happened today, there is such proliferation of the media that all of you are smart people, you know basically what happened. You know that Gavaskar said something about Kohli, Anushka Sharma responded to that. You know a lot of this stuff, you know farmers' protest is going on, you know what NCB is doing with the film actors, you know all that. So at this times, 4 of these 5 W's have gone. That is what, where, who, when, because you know all this already. There is the need for me to tell you the cricket score. So what am I left with as a modern journalist? Why, and how. And to that you add one more W, which is what next. So usually modern journalism, I keep saying, does now have to be built around these three elements: why, how, and what next. And yet occasionally you run into an issue where you think it's important to take up all the other four elements as well, all the other four W's as well, that is what, where, who, when. This Uyghur issue and Xinjiang issue is one of those. So let me tell you, first of all, what exactly has caused this. I told you about this SP report. Now this SP report talks about all these mosques having been destroyed. It talks about some famous shrines of Xinjiang having been destroyed. There is a number, there are satellite pictures, and as I speak, many of those will run on our screen. Essentially, these are Nathan Ruzer's tweets and the pictures he has with those tweets. These are quite telling, because this looks like there is a deliberate and strong campaign to change the character of the place so it loses somehow its distinct Islamic character. In fact, not just that, from 1997 on, Chinese government has banned pilgrimages. After that, there are big mazars here, which have been there. Pilgrims used to come in tens of thousands every year. Those have been locked up and then those have been destroyed and leveled. So you see pictures of those mazars as well. One of the important ones is in a place called Ordam, O-R-D-A-M, Ordam Mazar. That has been leveled, and not just that, in 2017, around time it got leveled, this report tells us that Rahile Dawood, the activist who used to study these shrines, document their history, educate people about them, she also disappeared. Her family lives overseas. They don't know where she is. They don't know whether she's dead or alive. They don't know whether she was charged with something. They don't know whether she's detained, jailed. Nobody has an idea where she is. The other thing that this study tells you is the issue of detention centers. Now, that's a story that's been out for quite some time. Even on the print.in, Colonel Vinayak Bhatt, who's a veteran of the army on satellite intelligence, he had done a series of stories for us about 3 years back, talking about, in fact, picking up pictures, satellite pictures of these detention centers, or what the Chinese call as training centers or reskilling centers, or in the old communist parlance, re-education centers. So this study also tells you that the Chinese have said that they have demolished, or they have now dismantled most of their detention centers. They said no. On the other hand, 60 of these detention centers have been expanded since 2018. And not just that, 14 new detention centers are being built. So what is the estimate of people who might be staying in these detention centers? That estimate varies from 8 lakh to 2 million, 20 lakh. Now, to put that number in perspective, remember that all of Xinjiang has a population of just about 2.5 crores, of which about a half are Uyghurs. That means this would put 1 in 5 Uyghurs inside a detention center. Now, I told you that we'll have to go a little bit into what, where, who, when. So this is the what that's making us do what we are doing today, this cut the clutter. Now, where is Xinjiang or Xinjiang, and what is it like? Now, if you look at the map of China, Xinjiang is like the northwest of China. It borders Tibet on this side. It's a very large province. It is more than 16 lakh square kilometers. You want to understand that in perspective, it is only 1/6 of China, but it is almost exactly or little less than half of India, that large. Its population, however, is just 2.5 crore. So imagine half the size of India and population 2% of India. In fact, a little less than 2% of India. Or you want to understand it a little more clearly, in size, Xinjiang is 7 times the size of UP. Its population is about 1/9 of UP. Once again, in size, compare Xinjiang with my little Haryana, but Haryana has population which is larger than Xinjiang. So Xinjiang is also very thinly populated. It has big, huge desert areas. The Tarim Basin is there. The Taklamakan Desert is there. The name of which means that once you enter this desert, you don't come out. It's a desert. There are no bushes also in it. It also has a geographical curiosity, which is the place which is geographically the farthest from the sea. It's called Zoustoyl Ellison Desert. So this is really in the middle of nowhere. Very large, very few people, and has borders with 8 countries. And there also there is a twist, because these 8 countries are Mongolia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Afghanistan, Russia. There's a tiny bit of Russia between Mongolia and Kazakhstan, Russia, Pakistan, and India. Now, what is the twist in this? The twist in this is that if you look at the official map of India, which is with all of the POK, Gilgit, Baltistan back in India, that is our official map of India, then Pakistan will not have a border with Xinjiang or with China for that matter. This will be a very complicated thing for Pakistan and for China. That's why this region is crucial, and that's why Kashmir issue becomes so crucial for China as well. So sometimes the answers to questions of higher strategy lie in geography, and that happens in the Himalayas more than anywhere else. Now, I will also tell you, since we are on what, we've told you where, and I'm telling you, getting to what is it that caused this trouble? Now, this area was essentially a Mongol area. In about 10th century, 11th century, it converted to Islam. Until then, it was ruled by a Buddhist ruler. So there are also relics of Buddhist monuments, monasteries, etc. there, which have mostly now been either in disrepair or they've been destroyed. Now, when the Muslim rulers, the Mongols, conquered Xinjiang and converted to Islam, then this became something that was loosely called, remember this, Mughalistan, because Mughals essentially were Mongols. That is where they came from. So those Mongols who had left Mongolia came in here, and then Islam grew, and this province or this area became essentially Islamic. They kept fighting with the Chinese rulers, that is Ming Dynasty, and then it was Qing Dynasty later between 1644 and 1941, which made this a part of China. The Chinese, on the other hand, insist that Xinjiang has been a part of China since 200 BC. There was always trouble between communists and religion. And religion in China was the strongest, religious pull was the strongest among its Muslim minorities. That is essentially Uyghurs and Huis, and there are some more, there's a whole bunch of them, but you know, they then become very small minorities. But if you want, I can give you their numbers. So there are about 8 of these Muslim groups. Smallest one out of those is Tatars, who are just about 5,000 people. So you will see these names of these groups on the screen. Now, the Chinese communists have had trouble because Mao Zedong, in the very beginning, said that, look, ethnicity and religion are two terrible things. He ran into both in Xinjiang. He ran into both in Tibet also, but he ran into both in Xinjiang as well. And Xinjiang has more population than Tibet. And also remember, it's 1.5 times the size of Tibet. So he ran into both, and the idea then was to suppress religiosity, which meant suppressing Islam. Now, it went on for some time in the Great Leap Forward. Religion and ethnicity were attacked between 1958 and 62. Then again, after 1966, when the Cultural Revolution began, these attacks again started, but significantly, Muslim mosques and places of worship were not desecrated or destroyed during the Cultural Revolution. In 1976, they were still standing. It is after 1997 that some riots took place. In one set of riots, 200 people died in Urumqi, the capital of the region. Then there were several smaller riots and killings, and you will see some of those dates running on my screen. There were 96 people killed in a knife attack. In Yarkand, Yarkand is an important place, I'll tell you about that as a sidelight. Just a few days after that, the chief imam of the Yarkand mosque was also killed in a stabbing attack. Sounds a little bit like some of the things that happened in Kashmir. So something like that happened there. It was after that that the Chinese Communist Party thought that this was an area of concern, and this is also when a proliferation of mosques took place. Remember, that is when the Saudis are spending a lot of money in large parts of the world, including some parts of India, in financing mosque building. So lots of mosques were coming up, and the Chinese Communist Party got worried because they don't like riots. There were a couple of terror attacks. There was an attack in the city where two cars laden with explosives were driven into a crowd and explosives were thrown at them. And this was a crowd essentially of Han migrants from other parts of China. So this got the country, the government, the Communist Party really alarmed. There was also a failed plane hijacking incident. When that happened, then they widened this attack on Muslim minorities and linked it to George Bush's global war on terror. They said, just because you're waging a war on terror in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, AFPAC region, or in parts of Middle East, so are we in one region where we have the same influences. There it started. It picked up then further when Xi Jinping came in, because Xi Jinping made a speech in 2014. It was a secret speech, but the New York Times found it and published it. In that speech, he warned against the toxicity of religious extremism. This is in quotes, toxicity of religious extremism. And he also said, quotes, we need to use the tools of dictatorship to exterminate Islamic extremism. We need to use the tools of dictatorship to eliminate Islamic extremism. And Chinese government then blamed a group called East Turkestan Islamic Movement, which they said were leading these terror attacks. So East Turkestan Islamic Movement became like their Lashkar-e-Taiba or Hizbul Mujahideen. So they began to attack that. Except when they attack those groups, that becomes an excuse for attacking the entire community and also attacking the entire religion. So that is when de-Islamization started. So increasingly other restrictions came. Government employees were banned from saying their prayers during office hours. After that, Ramzan fasts were curtailed. After that, mosque visits were curtailed. Then increasingly mosques were taken over, and you will see some pictures. Many of these mosques then became restaurants, even bars or shops. Other mosques, you will see one more in this ASPI report, which was a huge mosque. That mosque was destroyed, just the facade stands, and there are banners outside saying that Communist Party workers, government employees are not allowed to come and worship here. So this was then like a calibrated attack on Islamic religiosity. Then Muslim names, 30 plus Muslim sounding names, including Muhammad, were banned. People were then arrested and put in detention centers for all kinds of alleged crimes, including visiting troublesome countries, quote unquote, like Turkmenistan, like Turkey, etc., who are all friends of China now, but also for doing something as small, as tiny as texting each other verses from the Holy Quran. And that is how these detention centers got filled with million plus people. And if you see these pictures of detention centers, I'm showing you a story. See what they look like. They look like the maximum security prisons. Now the Chinese call these vocational centers or training centers. In fact, Shohrat Zakir, who's the governor of Xinjiang, he says these are boarding schools where we teach people skills. But then in these places, Ramzan fasting is not allowed. In these places, they are forced to pledge loyalty to Chinese Communist Party every day and renounce Islam. In these prisons, they sing praises of communism, also learn Mandarin, so they increasingly forget their own native language. Every part of these facilities is covered with cameras and mics. There are many other allegations and many other insinuations which I will not mention because we have no substantiation. But if you go and Google, you will find that globally there is a lot of concern now about what's going on, and even the number of camps now, all the satellite data tells you that since 2017-18, when there were 39 camps, the number has tripled now. So more and more people are being put into camps. Now there are more reports and more data, and there are some that we can vouch for because we trust them, like NYT and SP. Although, mind you, the Chinese government has called the SP report total nonsense. They've also said that SP is funded by American sources, so you know where it's coming from. And this is now becoming quite an issue between America and China, because I'm also sharing with you an article that Mike Pompeo, the US Secretary of State, has written on the US government State Department website on the persecution of Islam in China. It's an ironical world. It's not even funny, this world. This world, in fact, Rona, you get into a state of Rona Aina Aaye Hansi. I mean, you have a situation where millions of Muslims are being persecuted and systematically de-Islamized. Millions, about 10 million, a population of about 10 million. But no Muslim nation is complaining. In fact, some of the largest Muslim nations are China's closest friends. Indonesia, Iran, Turkey, which already has a large set of refugees coming in from Xinjiang. These are China's closest friends. Saudi Arabia is not complaining. The Gulf countries are not complaining because China is too big for them to complain. But America is complaining. So you can call it Begane ki shadi mein Abdullah Devana, or you can call it what I called it. You don't know whether to cry or laugh. So it is Trump's America which is now pushing back very strongly on this issue. That gives the Chinese the opportunity to say that all this criticism and all this that's coming is motivated, and all this data, including SP's data, is fake because it's funded by the Americans. It's an American operation. So that is the complexity there. But there is this report that we'll share with you, and I'll give you a link also. Obviously, this looks like a group which is an activist group which talks about forced birth control in Xinjiang, and it says that 80% of all IUDs in 2018, 80% of all IUDs, that is intrauterine devices, what in the past used to be called loop in India, if you remember old family planning ads, 80% of those in all of China have been installed in that year in the Xinjiang province. So you know that there's a big effort to control the population there. Not just that, there's been a forced sterilization of Uyghur women, and the estimates range from 14% to 34% of all married women within childbearing age. In fact, if you have more than three children, even though you are a minority, it is an offense for which you can be sent to the detention center. Birth control violations are taken very, 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 very seriously. And yet another report that we share with you, again, it looks like an activist group. So once again, we can't vouch for it. This is Abdu Veli Ayub, who has done this big report, his group, by talking to Xinjiang refugees in Turkey on the stories of Uyghurs, what's happening with them in Xinjiang. So in good faith, I'm sharing this with you. I am not vouching for it. These are 4,577 stories that they put together after interviewing a large bunch of Uyghur refugees in Turkey. So you see all that, and I will now tell you something that I said earlier. I said Yarkand has an interesting little sidelight to which I am bringing you now in conclusion. So Yarkand used to be a khanate. It used to be a place where very powerful khans ruled, and these were old Mongoloids. They come from Mongolia, and they were direct descendants of Timur. So who were the other direct descendants of Timur that we might know better? That is Babur, Humayun, Akbar. That was a Timurid dynasty as well. So while one stream came past Afghanistan, Kabul, into India directly and came to Delhi, that's Babur in 1526, he won the Battle of Panipat against Ibrahim Lodi. In 1530, another Mongoloid Khan or Mongoloid Sultan called Sultan Syed Khan, who ruled Yarkand. He left Yarkand with an army and came to conquer India through Kashmir and through what is now Ladakh. In fact, it is him, and he came in that period between Babur and Humayun, when India had some instability. Humayun was taking his time settling down, then Humayun lost power. So he came in that period, and it was on his way back then, when he was going back to Yarkand, that he died. He died in a place which was quite desolate, but was a kind of place for caravanserais to hang around. And because he was a big, rich guy, so Mr. Daulat Beg, Oldi means died in the local language. So that is the place called Daulat Beg Oldi, which is now of such strategic significance in the India-China conversations.